The late, brilliant Steve Jobs said, "I think the biggest innovation of the 21st century will be at the intersection of biology and technology. A new era is beginning." And if you want to see how biotech can change the world of health and also create extraordinary value for investors, you need to look no further than Amgen, one of the world's leading independent biotech companies. Now, looking no further means me here today in London and my guest in San Diego, but it's not every day we get to talk to the CEO of one of the top 60 most valuable companies in the US, with a market cap of around $130 billion. So today I'm thrilled to welcome Amgen's CEO and Chairman, Bob Bradway. Bob, welcome to the Money Makers podcast.
Thank you, Simon. Great to be here with you.
Well, Bob, we met at Morgan Stanley a long time ago. You were there for, I think, nearly 20 years. We actually both left the same year. And you were known as the gentleman banker, setting very high standards. And you've had a very impressive second career. And we're going to talk about that, in a minute. And I hope, because biotechnology is such an intriguing and complicated area, that today we can talk a little bit about the changing scene for drug discovery, the scale of costs and timelines involved in finding, developing, and gaining approval for new drugs, the role of technology in this process, the big unmet medical opportunities for Amgen and key drivers of your business, and exploring some of those themes within that, biologics, genetics, where most of us are unschooled, and a sense check on where we are on some of the world's biggest problems like heart disease and the work you've done on obesity. So not much to cover then, Bob, that's the good news. And I think that I have to ask you, because we love a little bit of perspective. Growing up, were you born into a medical family?
I was. I grew up believing I'd be a physician like my father, who was a surgeon. And for most of my academic career, that's all I had an interest in, was biology and the idea of moving on to medical school and eventually becoming a surgeon and doing what I had dreamed of doing since a young age. But as I got through college, I had some great experiences, had a chance to see inside the life of medicine, the program at Harvard and at Johns Hopkins at Ohio State. And yeah, I realized, while it was very interesting, there were other things in the world as well. And I was fortunate to have an opportunity to discover an opportunity at Morgan Stanley to join what was then a nascent group in biotechnology. And the rest is history from there.
So you got a BSc in biology from Amherst, and then later on you get an MBA from Harvard. But I have to ask you, how did you earn your first dollar?
Mowing lawns.
Okay. In California?
No, that was in Ohio. I grew up in Columbus, Ohio, where the lawns are lush, and I learned to cut them and bag them as a young 12, 13-year-old.
Right. So let's just talk briefly about that Morgan Stanley experience, because investment banking was relatively new concept, and it obviously kept you there for quite a long time. What was the lure?
Well, I had a great experience at Morgan Stanley. I was fortunate to be part of a team that was doing exciting things. I joined the firm in 1985, which was the very beginning innings of the biotechnology industry. Had an opportunity to work with companies that were doing exciting things, raising capital, combining with other companies. And really, I think what kept me in the game there, Simon, for 20 years was the quality of the people and the opportunity working with great clients.
And if one sort of was thinking that somebody has a master plan, they would say, well, smart, you join Amgen as the VP in operations, you move up to CFO, and then bang, you're CEO in May 2012. Now, was it really as well thought out as that?
No, of course it wasn't, Simon. But I was willing to leave a career in investment banking to join Amgen because I believed in what the company was doing. I had a great opportunity to join an area of the company that gave me a chance to learn a whole bunch of completely new things and really throw myself into what is the science and technology of biotechnology. And then, as you say, after a year or so of doing that, I became CFO, which was a little bit more familiar territory for me. And then after a few years as CFO, became president and chief operating officer, and then became CEO and chairman after that.
So, Amgen, let's talk a little bit about its evolution and then talk about its current shape and size.
So Amgen was founded in 1980, and we were founded really at the dawn of what was a biotechnology revolution. There were hundreds or even thousands of companies started at the same time as Amgen. And I would note, Simon, there are really two of us left from that original wave of biotechnology companies that crept up in the landscape in the United States. Only two of us left as independent, thriving biotechnology companies. And so our evolution was one of a couple of very successful breakthrough medicines. Our first medicine changed the practice of nephrology. And we quickly followed that with two other medicines that were equally practice of medicine changing innovations, in this case, in the cancer field. So the story of Amgen is one of innovation. It's one of first-in-class medicines making a profound difference for people who were suffering or struggling with really tough diseases.
And I got to just quote the stats, because in June 83, there's an IPO that raises nearly $4 million. And 12 years later, in 92, Amgen hits $1 billion of product sales. So it was absolute liftoff. But let's just maybe recap right now today. Where are you in terms of physical locations? I know that you did revenues of $26 billion last year, but just give us a sense of scale and size.
Sure. So Amgen is based in 102 countries around the world. Our headquarters is in Southern California. We have research operations really around the world, but the bulk of our activities in research and development area are in San Francisco, in Southern California, in Boston, Massachusetts, Munich in Germany, Reykjavik in Iceland, and then a number of development facilities in the UK and another major markets around the world, as you'd expect, Japan, China, et cetera. So we're represented now, as I said, across 102 countries around the world. We have about 27 medicines that are approved and on the market in three therapeutic categories, inflammation, anti-cancer medicines, and then medicines that address cardiovascular disease, bone disease, and nephrology, and other areas that we call general medicine.
Well, we're going to dive into a few of those, but help me and help others who are not initiated. What is essentially the difference between biotech and pharma?
Well, when you think of the tablets and the pills that we take, that's what we associate traditionally with pharmaceuticals. So those are what we call small molecules, and they're a whole lot less complex than biologic molecules or the proteins that our industry was founded on. So the starting point is simple pharmaceutical chemical synthesis. Those are the pills that we take, in contrast to the complex biologic medicines that this industry was founded to develop.
Right. And so if I say, if you are asked to distill your mission today, thinking ahead for the next decade, how would you distill it?
Very simple. Our mission is to serve patients suffering from serious disease. We do that by advancing innovative, usually first-in-class medicines that are designed to meet a very important major unmet medical need. And we do that in, as I said earlier, we do that in three therapeutic categories. We do it in immunology, we do it in cancer, and we do it in general medicine.
Now, we all read as laymen about the testing process. And I read in one of your research documents when it was a discussion on testing with mice, is you said that mice, they aren't terribly good at predicting what will happen in humans. And that's one reason why it takes 10 plus years and costs $2.5 billion to advance a drug from its earliest stages to approval. Is that really true?
Well, it is certainly true that it takes 10 to 15 years and in excess of $2.5 billion on average to develop a drug. I think the reference to mice is that, but before we're able to enter human experiments, we have to demonstrate for regulators around the world that the medicine that we want to explore in humans has a chance of being effective and also that it's likely to be safe. So we establish that in animal models, and very often that means in mice. But the conundrum, Simon, is that in order for us to enter human clinical experiments, we have to have been successful in an animal model. And so we have 100% success in the animal model. We then move it into humans, and we find that fewer than 1 in 10 actually make it through and become approved drugs. And that's because animal models, in particular mice, don't represent very well what actually happens in humans. So that's what led us to want to think differently about how to develop drugs, and led us in particular to want to look at the field of human genetics as a way to increase our odds of success in what is a very challenging, risky, expensive field, which is drug discovery and drug development.
So Let's just start with the world's big killer. I mean, if I'm right in the research that I read, cardiovascular disease causes a third of the world's deaths. Again, I've got to say to you, did I get that wrong?
Well, there's no disease that is responsible for more death and destruction on our planet than cardiovascular disease. So the morbidity and mortality from cardiovascular disease is far and away the biggest public health challenge that we face as a society today.
And just tell me a little bit how Amgen, that's been pretty significant in this space, and you've had it. Amgen's bold ambition is to halve the number of cardiovascular events by 2030. So just tell us a little bit about how you are hoping to do that.
Well, in conjunction with some of the major medical societies, we've set ourselves a goal, as you say, to try to halve the number of cardiovascular events in this country by 2030. And Simon, that reflects our conviction that we know what the causes of heart disease in our society today are. And a very important contributor to heart disease is that people are wandering around with LDL levels. LDL is the bad cholesterol. LDL levels that are just simply too high.
Got it. Now, let's talk about genetics, because I think, again, it'd be fair to say that lots of people have become more aware of the broad, you know, what happened when we started mapping the genomes. But you've got some really interesting work that you've done. And when you mentioned the geographies, of course, you mentioned Iceland, which most biotech companies or pharma companies wouldn't. In fact, most companies, period, wouldn't have Iceland on their map. Tell us a little bit about how you're approaching genetics.
Well, Iceland is a particularly important place in the field of human genetics. And the reason it is, Simon, is that, as you know, Iceland is an isolated island in the middle of the North Atlantic. And for hundreds and even thousands of years, there was very little trafficking of people on and off the island. That created what we call a founder population. And so the genetics on the island of Iceland make for a very interesting laboratory to try and understand the genetic conditions that predispose people to disease or to a life of good health. And so that has been the main focus in our human genetics has occurred on the island of Iceland through a company that we acquired in 2012 called Decode Genetics. And so the beauty of a founder population like that is that if there are rare variants in an individual's genome or gene profile that gives rise to a serious disease, we're more likely to find them there than we will be able to find them in, say, an outbred population like continental Europe or the United States. So it is a prime location for trying to understand genetics, and as I said, what causes people to be ill and what enables people conversely to live long, healthy lives. And so we have expanded now well beyond Iceland, so we can compare what we've learned about the genetics of that isolated population with more diverse populations around the world. And through that activity, we've established ourselves as the world's leader in using human genetics to try to understand disease and how to develop therapies that can prevent or improve the outcomes for people who are suffering from challenging disorders.
And can you give us a sense of how important that might be in the pipeline of drug discovery? Is genetics going to be, you know, a third of kind of new formulations that you expect to find?
What I would say, Simon, is that we do expect it will be very important. And if we look at our pipeline today, something on the order of 2/3 of our molecules in our pipeline outside of cancer, we'll talk about that separately if you'd like, but outside of cancer, about 2/3 of our molecules are ones which we believe are genetically validated. So we're pursuing them because we believe we have genetic evidence to suggest that if we perturb the pathway that we're intercepting with our therapy, we can have a beneficial outcome on the disease process that we're targeting.
And behind all of this is the sense, if I translate it into, you know, investment speak, is that you as a company are pursuing significantly important unmet medical needs for which I read higher risk, but significantly higher rewards.
It's certainly higher risk when you're trying to innovate and develop first-in-class medicine. So, when you're developing a first-in-class medicine, you can't rely on the data that others have generated through time to show that that the outcome you're intending to achieve is likely to happen. So, we are plowing new fields. An example of that, Simon, in cardiovascular disease is a medicine that we're in final stage of development for that lowers something known as LP little a. It turns out that LP little a is another very important risk factor, which gives rise to heart disease through the process known as atherosclerosis. And unfortunately, it's a protein which is not affected by other drugs that are available today or by diet and lifestyle changes. So if you are born with a high level of LP little a, you are at high risk of heart attack and stroke. And many people who are born with this high level of this protein have them at a very young age in life. So we are developing what will be a first-in-class medicine. And as we've talked about before, Simon, that is a process that takes 10 to 15 years, takes on average more than $2.5 billion. And you finish the $2.5 billion of investment, and only then do you turn over the card to see whether you've been successful in preventing cardiovascular events by lowering the parameter that you were trying to lower. And that's the risk in drug discovery when you're trying to be first. Now, the reward, obviously, is it has the potential to be a therapy which, for the first time in the history of mankind, can make a difference and enable people born with this protein challenge to live a full, long, healthy life without the risk of heart attack or stroke. So the reward is obviously meaningful if we're successful in advancing a therapy like that.
Clear. Now, the other silo, which appears to be very important for you, and you in an earlier call helped explain it, is biologics. And I'd love you just to flesh that out so we can understand what it means to you at Amgen.
Yeah. Well, when we say biologics, Simon, we're largely referring to medicines that are proteins. And let me contrast what a protein medicine is with what many of us are familiar with, whether the pills we take in the morning or the evening. So those pills are small molecules. They are pharmaceutical medicines that are made using the tools available to us in chemical synthesis, for example. So if we just take aspirin, aspirin is a relatively simple molecule. Our high school children could synthesize aspirin in a high school biology laboratory and make an effective version of that medicine. So, you know, in terms of its size and molecular complexity, relatively straightforward. Proteins, by contrast, are thousands or even tens of thousands of times more complicated than that aspirin. And they are molecules which you can't just swallow orally. They are molecules that are largely injected or given intravenously to patients for a variety of reasons. But the point is, they are very complex medicines. And the magic of biology and biotechnology was that in the late 1970s, it became possible for the first time to create these complex proteins by doing it the way Mother Nature does it. So how does Mother Nature make these complex medicines? They're made in living cells. And some experiments in the 1970s showed that you could take the genetic instructions from one organism and then inject it into another and create the protein, the desired protein. And that enabled us to create medicines for diseases that we knew were the result of deficient proteins for the first time. Again, Amgen was at the vanguard of doing that, and our first few medicines were successful in the way you described, Simon, and that success gave encouragement to hundreds and hundreds of other companies to try to repeat what Amgen had done by making available for the first time these proteins that doctors knew were the key to keeping people well, but which doctors had no means of otherwise producing.
So one of your papers that I read was on obesity, and it was titled Why It's About Biology, Not Behavior. And that sort of had me scratching my head a bit. So I'd love you to just expand on that.
Yeah. Well, obesity exists at the intersection of genetics and the environment. So it may surprise you to learn that something on the order of 40 to 70% of the inter-individual variability in obesity or body mass index is accounted for by genetics. Now, there are very good reasons from an evolutionary standpoint why that might be true, or why that it evolved the way it did. So you can imagine that there was once upon a time an evolutionary advantage for people who were able to store energy more effectively as a result of their genetics. The challenge, of course, is we live in an environment today where there's an abundance of food available to us. So it's no longer as advantageous as it once might have been for us to be able to store excess energy as fat. And in fact, Simon, the unfortunate thing of storing excess calories as fat is that those fat cells are not metabolically inert. They're active and they're sending mischievous signals around the body. And if there are enough of those fat cells for a long enough period of time, they give rise to a variety of other disorders and diseases. And that's why obesity is the enormous problem that it is today from a public health standpoint. There are lots of these chronic diseases that we're all familiar with that are such a challenge for our societies today that are caused by this lifetime exposure to too much fat or adipose tissue. And again, that's why we and others are excited about, for the first time, being able to introduce therapies that might make a difference in that disease.
So one of our former guests, who you know, Dame Kate Bingham, said that you, Amgen, if not you personally, acquired one of her early portfolio companies, Micromet, in the cancer space. And her question was simply, was it a good acquisition?
We're very, very excited about Micromet. In fact, if you've read The Emperor of Maladies, if you haven't, I'd encourage you to read it. But if you've read it, the book starts with a patient who's suffering from a relapse of this form of leukemia. And you get a sense for how terrifying it was for the physicians treating such patients because they knew they had very little, if anything, available to help patients at that stage of the disease. And that's where Micromet comes in. And just briefly, Simon, what Micromet does is we engineer a protein which on one end binds the cancer cell. So cancer cells very often have on their surface a distinctive signature. And in the case of acute lymphoblastic leukemia cells, they have a very distinct signature. So on one end, our protein binds that distinct signature. And on the other end, our protein binds a cell from the immune system. And the cell from the immune system then grabs hold of that cancer cell and destroys it. And so the idea is to try to harness the body's own immune cells and get them to hone in on these cancer cells that are circulating in the body and eliminate them. And again, the data show spectacular results from that. And more broadly, we're exploring this in a number of different diseases. I think people are very excited right now about the results that we see in small cell lung cancer, where unfortunately the long-term survival rate is a dismal 3% today. And then there are a variety of other cancers as well where we are applying the Micromet technology. So the answer to Kate is yes, we're thrilled with the acquisition and we think it's been great for us and for the field more generally.
Well, I'm sure she's very happy. She may think that she sold it too cheaply, but that was a long time ago. So she was, as you may know, a guest on the show, a very popular guest last year, and again, described her area of work, I thought, brilliantly. I was catching up with a former Morgan Stanley colleague, Tyrell Young, who asked the question, how is Amgen using AI to assist in its drug development?
Yeah, well, this is an incredibly exciting moment in time. You know, you referred to Steve Jobs at the outset of the call. I think in so many areas, he was a visionary, and in this field, he was as well. You know, we like to say, Simon, that we're living at the dawn of the biocentury. And, you know, we're living in a moment in time where the knowledge that we're generating in the field of biology is truly staggering. The pace of change and the rate at which our knowledge is improving is really, really impressive. And one of the reasons that it is we're able to deploy technology now against the huge amount of data that we generate in biology to better understand what the data are trying to tell us. And AI will help extend and improve, no doubt, the rate at which we're innovating and the insights that we're generating. And we've been very aggressive at deploying tools of machine learning and artificial intelligence across our business. So from the research phase right through to manufacturing and our commercial interactions. But just very briefly, Simon, let me touch on one of the big moments in the field, which occurred in the summer of 2021 when Google's DeepMind subsidiary, which will be familiar to you from its presence in the UK, Google's DeepMind unit revealed and made available for the first time its software. And that software enables us to predict the structure of proteins. And you know, that was a huge moment in the artificial intelligence field, but also in the field of biology. In the artificial intelligence field, because scientists there had been trying for decades to figure out how to program in such a way that you could anticipate how these large complex proteins come together and create a three-dimensional structure. That structure is important to us in the world of drug discovery and development. We need to know what the shape of a protein is in order to figure out where to grab onto it with a medicine that we're trying to use against it. And so the way that we've had to do it historically is by crystallizing a protein and looking at it with very expensive equipment. It takes months and months and sometimes years to do, using highly trained PhDs to help us discern the structure of a molecule. But when DeepMind revealed its AlphaFold software, and then there were several others in quick succession, it became possible to generate a computer model for these three-dimensional structures. And so that has enabled us to cut out, potentially, not in every instance, but to cut out months and in some cases even years of work at the outset of trying to design medicines. So we've had some successes already. I'm sure others in the field have, and no doubt artificial intelligence will open the door to another era of more rapid and hopefully more profound innovation.
Right. Stepping back from the biology, you're running an immense corporation. What would you say is sort of kind of your biggest challenge in getting your arms around that?
Well, you know, I think, Simon, one of the things that people sometimes misunderstand or don't fully appreciate is how important it is to have alignment in a large organization. And, you know, we're very fortunate that we have tens of thousands of people around the world, and as I mentioned previously, in more than 100 countries. But we're very fortunate that we have a tool which works really well to align all of us, which is our mission. And the beautiful thing is, you know, everybody understands at this company that they have an opportunity to make a difference for a patient that's suffering from a serious disease. And, you know, it's a special feeling. So alignment and making sure that everybody understands the mission or purpose of the organization. And, you know, we have that North Star. It has served us well since we were founded, and it continues to today.
And would you say that people are unified in seeing what the biggest challenge or challenges are over the next 5 years?
Well, you know, I think we're fortunate as well. And certainly, I think our leaders understand the challenges that we're facing. The challenges we're facing include, obviously, a high inflationary environment. We face pressures globally on drug prices, and we face an incredibly competitively intense environment, which means we need to move quickly. We need to recognize that we're in a hotly competitive field. And, you know, one of the things that Amgen prizes is competing intensely to win. It's not just about the effort. It's about making a difference for patients. We want to win for the patients. We recognize that we're in a race. We're in a race against serious disease, and often we're in a race against our competitors as well, to be the first to define the benefit of a new therapy for people that are suffering from challenging diseases.
Akin to the investment world, you guys are going to get setbacks. Tell me a little bit about how you deal with them as they come along. And I mean a little bit emotionally, because we've got leaders who may be CIOs or running hedge funds, etc. And, you know, this is when the wind is in your face. It's very interesting to hear how leaders react.
Yeah. Well, we're in a business where 9 out of 10 times we fail. And, you know, if you can fail, you know, 8 times out of 10, you're a Hall of Famer. So we're in a business where failure is just a fact of life. And sometimes that failure occurs 10, 12, you know, 15 years after we've committed and been investing in a project. And that can be frustrating as heck. You know, the beautiful thing about our field, however, is that we learn from failure. So, you know, when we've embarked on a project that we had high hopes for and invested a lot of time and energy in, and we generate that final set of data and the data tell us the medicine didn't work, of course, that's discouraging. But, you know, the beauty of it is we're able to step back and say, okay, what did we learn? Is there anything that we learned that makes us want to go back at it differently, or anything we can learn that we apply to the next project that we're working on? So, you know, on the one hand, it's the most challenging feature of our world is that, you know, people can work very hard on things that look really interesting, but they just don't work out in the body. You know, on the other side, it makes those moments when you do have an aha breakthrough and you generate the data that shows you've really made a difference for a patient and the patient's family, it makes those all the more special. And we've been very special, or we've been very lucky, Simon, rather, in our history to have had a lot of those moments. So, you know, whether it's for bone disease, in particular, the risk of fracture due to osteoporosis, or whether it's from kidney disease. We've had those moments where, you know, we look at that data and we know that we are sitting on a really important, valuable innovation for, again, for patients that are suffering from tough challenges.
Well, none of us would survive in the investment world if we had those success rates. So I think I chose the right profession. Bob, I've got a few closing questions for you. Who's been and why was that person a significant mentor to you?
Well, I've been fortunate to have a few great mentors in my life. I would say my predecessor was an extraordinary mentor, extraordinary teacher and coach. So I was very, very fortunate to have someone like him as I transitioned from the financial services industry into biotechnology. I've also been very fortunate to have a former board member who was a distinguished leader of McKinsey for many years, considered one of the founders of strategy, to serve as a mentor throughout my career here at Amgen. So I've benefited tremendously from having people that have been through some of the things that I'm going through and can help me think through challenges and look around corners. So really grateful to them for that.
And when at the other end you are talking and your colleagues are talking to young people, students who are thinking about joining Amgen and the world of biotech, what advice would you give them?
First of all, I'd say it's an incredibly rewarding field to be part of. One of the beauties of being in an organization like ours is the ability to make a difference for people at a moment in their lives when they really need help. And so biotechnology gives you the opportunity to be part of an organization that's there when a patient and their family are most desperate for some innovation that can give them prospect of a quality life, you know, can help them return to health and live a fulfilling, healthy, long life. And so having that as a, again, as a North Star in an industry like this is, I think, what attracts people to the industry. And those who stay here find that that becomes a really important part of what makes them tick inside their organization. So first thing I'd say, incredibly rewarding opportunity. The second thing I would say is be prepared for a pace of change that is just simply stunning. And, you know, maybe encourage them to be a little bit humble as well. You know, I think sometimes we believe we know an awful lot about, you know, for example, biology. But, you know, with each passing day, I'm reminded how little we actually know today about this field. So it's an exciting, fast-changing field and an opportunity, I think, to really make a difference.
Now, Amgen is a founding member of the 110 Coalition with the goal of hiring 1 million Black Americans into well-paid jobs over the next decade. How do you help that journey?
Well, ours is an industry in which, in particular, African Americans have been underrepresented. And so one of the things that we're focusing on is trying to understand what have been some of the reasons historically why we haven't been able to attract people to our industry from that community, and what are the things that we need to do to make sure that when we do attract people to our organization, we can help them develop and flourish and thrive. And so we've committed publicly to being part of a group that has a 10-year commitment to try to improve the representation of African Americans, Black Americans in family-sustaining career-related roles. And it's been an interesting journey. One of the things I think we and others in the field have learned is that we probably have been specifying credentials for our roles that were not necessary and that had the effect of not making us attractive to some of the talent that we're trying to draw into our organization. So we had to rethink how we go about recruiting, how we specify the kinds of things we think we need for the jobs we're hiring for, and then to make sure that we're creating an environment where when people get here, they feel like they belong and feel like they can make a contribution.
Got it. Now, Bob, I know that, although it's a long time ago, you were always a keen golfer. And we ask this question occasionally to a guest who has that passion. If you could play any golf course in the world, where would it be? And you're allowed to take one guest. Who would that guest be?
Oh, my heavens. All right. Is it a sunny day? If you grant me a sunny day, Simon, I might say I'd go up to northern Scotland, fly into Inverness and rent a car and drive out to Royal Dornoch, because on a sunny day, there are just few more wonderful experiences than that. And Who would I play on that course with? Well, Simon, I hope you are available on that sunny day. We'll get up there together and we'll have fun thinking about the old times.
Oh, gosh. Well, I'm sure you can do much better than me. Thank you, though, very much. I'll be there and at the airport at Inverness. Look, that's been a terrific conversation, and we could go on and I could pick your brains, but I think you've given us a great summary of your industry, of Amgen's priorities, of the complexities, which, my goodness, make the regular investing world seem significantly more welcoming and less hostile. But, boy, you're making a real difference. So, that's been absolutely terrific. I've taken two things away. The book that I've never heard of, which we'll put on our show notes, is The Emperor of Maladies. So that'll be on the list. So thank you. And you have said it. It's it jives with what the late Steve Jobs has said, but we are at the dawn of the biocentury, and the speed of change and the tools which are being employed are probably unrecognizable from our predecessors. So thank you so much for giving us your time today, Bob, and for sharing so much with us.
Thank you, Simon. Great pleasure to be here with you.